thanks very much for inviting me to speak today. I'm a research fellow in public health sociology. I'm speaking on behalf of myself and my colleague, Dr. Lucy Platt, who's a lecturer in public health epidemiology. And combined, we have just about 22 years of experience of research on sex workers. I'm going to talk about the now established evidence on the health harms of sex work criminalisation. We've heard much about this today. I'm going to be supporting that with some of the stats from the literature. I'm going to be talking about harms around violence, sexual ill health, and reduced access to healthcare. Harms that are reinforced, not alleviated, by criminalising clients. I'll also discuss the evidence on the health benefits of decriminalisation. So firstly, by criminalisation, I mean all laws and police enforcement in relation to adult sex work, including those targeting third parties and clients. And by decriminalisation, I mean the removal of all such penalties. When discussing health harms, I follow the World Health Organization's definition of health as a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being. I'll pay particular attention to violence, as I mentioned, but I will also discuss sexual and emotional health and access to healthcare. First, to consider violence. Last year, a global systematic review published by Kathleen Deering and colleagues showed that female sex workers were up to 7 times more likely to experience recent violence by any party if they'd previously been targeted by sex work criminalisation. One included study, a survey that Dr. Platt, myself and colleagues conducted in London in 2008, found that women working indoors who had ever been arrested or in prison were 2.6 times more likely to have been assaulted by a client in the past year. That is, regardless of where they worked, whether or not they had a partner, were born in the UK or used drugs. Women previously involved in the criminal justice system were at greater risk of violence at work now. But what do these data tell us about how criminalisation affects violence? Well, as we've heard today, evidence from the UK and elsewhere shows how criminalisation displaces sex workers into less safe work locations and rushes screening of clients. In Canada, Shannon and colleagues' work found that cis and transgendered women who worked away from main streets to avoid police attention were more than twice as likely to experience subsequent violence by clients. And that was regardless of their age, ethnicity, work location, drug use and housing situation. And as we've heard from Jane Pitcher's work with sex workers in the UK, laws against brothel keeping leave sex workers having to choose between safety and avoiding criminalisation. Evidence from Canada and Sweden shows that these harms are reinforced when the purchase of sex is criminalised. And I just want to illustrate this with a quote from an interview in Andrea Crucy's Vancouver study that Jo Kamer mentioned this morning. And she says, "While the police are going around chasing Johns away from pulling up beside you, I have to stay out for longer. Whereas if we weren't harassed, we'd be able to be more choosy. Because of being so cold and being harassed, I got into a car where I normally wouldn't have. The guy didn't look at my face right away. I just hopped in. And you know, he put something to my throat and I had to do it for nothing." As we've heard from many of the speakers today, fear of arrest, deportation, of not being taken seriously by police, or of being publicly identified, is widely documented to deter reporting of violence, including where clients are criminalised. And this, of course, offers effective impunity to perpetrators. This reiterates the vital role of initiatives such as National Ugly Mugs to facilitate reporting without fear of arrest, deportation, blame or disclosure. Secondly, I want to talk briefly about the harms of criminalisation on sex workers' wider health. Data from a range of countries links police enforcement with up to a 5-fold increased risk of HIV or sexually transmitted infection, and up to 4 times the likelihood of accepting more money for, being pressured into, or engaging in unprotected sex with clients. And again, drawing on data from Canada, for example, cis and transgender women were 3 times more likely to have been pressured into unprotected sex by a client if they had been displaced by police. And that was including through zoning restrictions for solicitation. So that's similar to the use of antisocial behaviour orders in the UK. And again, evidence from the UK and elsewhere shows that police enforcement rushes negotiations with clients and confiscation of condoms restricts risk reduction capacity, as we heard about in Scotland this morning. Although not much research has examined the emotional health impacts of criminalisation, sex workers in the UK and many other contexts have described the persistent stress of fearing arrest and of being publicly identified. Thirdly, I want to talk briefly about the impacts of criminalisation on access to health and social care. In Canada, areas that sex workers avoided due to policing overlap significantly with the location of most health and sex worker support services. And in the UK, we've heard about police raids on venues and sex work areas disrupting access to outreach services. Services that, as our 2008 research showed, are vital to sex workers' sexual and broader health. And as Jay Levy and P. Jacobson's research in Sweden has shown, anti-harm reduction approaches accompanying the Swedish model leave sex workers without access to vital resources and support. Finally, broader structural inequalities, such as housing and economic insecurity and stigma, are both exacerbated by criminalisation and are themselves documented risk factors for violence and ill health experienced by sex workers. Evidence from the UK and elsewhere shows how police fines and disruption of work increase economic pressures, whilst convictions or feared brothel keeping charges make it harder to access housing. Meanwhile, sex workers' lack of recognition as persons before the law, as Tina Sanders and Rosie Campbell put it, together with policies that construct sex workers as either deviant or as helpless female victims, reinforce stigma and ignore the diverse reality of sex workers' genders and lives. If we turn to decriminalisation, the outlook is far more hopeful. Evidence from New Zealand, some of which we heard about this morning, shows that since sex work was decriminalised in 2003, sex workers are now significantly more able to refuse clients and insist on condom use amid improved support from managers. And more than half of participants felt that police attitudes towards sex workers had improved. And bearing in mind, this was just a couple of years after decriminalisation was introduced. However, some participants continued to mistrust and fear stigma by the police, and they were far more likely to confide in and receive information on violent clients from the New Zealand Collective of Prostitutes. This reiterates both the vital importance of sex worker-led organisations and the continued need to challenge stigma against sex workers in state institutions, including beyond decriminalisation. And although for many sex workers in the UK HIV risk is low, it's worth drawing your attention to the stat published in The Lancet that was mentioned earlier this morning. This estimated that decriminalisation could avert up to 46% of cases of HIV among sex workers and clients over a decade globally. And this is if coupled with reduced client violence, reduced police harassment, safer work environments and increased condom use. Changes that experiences thus far in New Zealand suggest are achievable. So in conclusion, the evidence I've presented shows how criminalisation increases violence against sex workers and impacts negatively on sexual health and access to services, including where clients are criminalised. The public health evidence strongly supports full decriminalisation of sex work, including removal of penalties targeting third parties and clients. This must be accompanied by inclusive housing, welfare and migration policies that tackle inequalities, recognition of the diverse realities of sex work, and sustained funding for sex work projects, safety initiatives, and sex worker-led organisations that are vital sources of support for sex workers' health, safety, rights, and self-determination.